Republican presidential candidates will debate again tonight, but there will be a conspicuous absence. Senator Rand Paul will not be there. He's boycotting the event after being bumped from the main stage to the undercard debate. Fox Business Network says it's basing its decision on the latest polls, but Senator Paul says they're leaving out a key poll. And Senator Rand Paul joins us now on New Day. Great to have you here in studio. Morning. So are you still fighting this at this hour?
Yeah, I think the Republican Party, the media, they're making a big mistake by, you know, pushing me out of the debate, because I think I have a different voice, a unique voice in the party, and it's a mistake to really not have me in the debate. I think the polls, even the polls they say they were using, actually, we meet their criteria.
But how is the Republican Party pushing you out of the debate? Fox said it had these metrics. It announced its metrics of how it would sort of calculate the polls, and you didn't make the cut.
Actually, we did. If you use the Des Moines Register poll, we do make the cut. And it was performed during the expected window, the defined window.
Let me pull that up. Let me just show everybody, because this is the Des Moines Register poll, and it came out yesterday. It shows you in fifth place. You're at 5%. This is the one that you're hanging your hat on, but it wasn't released within the window. And didn't Fox always say it had to be conducted and released within a specific window?
It sounds kind of like a technicality when we're talking about a major national campaign. We've raised $25 million. We've been doing this for 2 years. We have 1,000 precinct chairs in Iowa. People have to realize that what the media is doing here is pre-deciding an election, or trying to pre-decide an election. I have an important voice. What do you think the liberty movement, the liberty voters in the Republican Party are thinking now? That the Republican Party, in league with one of the media networks, is saying, we're not going to let the liberty candidate on the stage.
So do you blame the RNC, or are you blaming Fox?
You know, I think it's both together. But the RNC made the rules, and then they've dictated the rules to the networks. And most of the time, the networks have accepted these rules. But if the Republican Party wants to be bigger, they need to not be excluding the one voice. I'm the one person on the stage saying that our intervention in the Middle East has actually aided and abetted and made terrorism worse, instead of saying, you know, we're going to have only one single voice in the Republican Party, or we're going to exclude the other voices. I think it's a big mistake for the Republican Party.
Is Fox open to your argument? Might you still make the main stage?
We're making the argument, but we haven't heard anything directly.
All right. I understand your logic. You've laid out your case here, but I don't understand your math. And here's why. You, at your campaign rallies, are getting what, about 300 people, several hundred people a pop?
We're actually probably getting bigger crowds than almost anyone other than Donald Trump.
Okay, let's say that you're getting 1,000 people a pop. Even at the undercard debate, the average of the viewership is 6 million people. You could reach 6 million potential voters tonight.
I think people in the media misunderstand this. It isn't about viewership. It's about being designated as part of the people who aren't going to win. There's only one debate tonight. Let's be honest about this. There's only one debate, and is that there is no equivalent. Would you take a spot at 3 in the morning versus your 9 a.m. or 7 a.m. spot of the morning shows? They aren't the same, and we're kidding ourselves, and we don't even describe them as the same.
What it is is
about predefining the race. We have not had one vote yet, and everybody's going crazy like Donald Trump has won the race already. And I think it's a mistake, and it disenfranchises the voters of Iowa or New Hampshire. Not one vote has been cast, and we're already deciding who's allowed to participate and who can't. I think it's a huge mistake.
But you're choosing to base it on the label of the undercard debate. Chris Christie, for instance, who's one of your rivals, famously said, put a podium somewhere and I'll show up. And in fact, yesterday he talked about how he believes that you're making a mistake not to want to show up. Let me just play it for you and you can respond. Here's Chris Christie on what he thinks about your decision. Listen to this.
I think it's a mistake on his part. I think if you're invited to debate and you're a serious candidate for President of the United States, you should debate, whether that debate's at 7 o'clock at night or whether it's 9 o'clock at night. The American people don't care.
The American people don't care what time it's on?
Yeah, well, I think this wouldn't be the first time Chris Christie was wrong about something. You know, we have a lot of big government Republicans like Christie that have been wrong about surveillance, wrong about the war, wrong about getting us involved in another war in the Middle East. So I don't really place a lot of stock in Christie's opinion.
Okay, but back to the math. These are 6 million potential voters, and you're saying I'm not going to speak to them.
No, the problem isn't, and I think this is what's misunderstood by people in the media. You don't understand that if you are designated as someone who is not in contention, that is very disruptive to a campaign with 3 weeks out. We don't consider that we have a second-tier campaign, and we're not going to announce to the American people that we are no longer in contention. because we absolutely are in contention. We have raised $25 million. We have announced more precinct chairs in Iowa than any other candidate has so far. We have a first campaign, and we can't accept an artificial designation by the media and by the party. And it's really showing that, does the party want to be bigger? Does the party want the liberty movement in the Republican Party? Do they want voices that say intervention in the Middle East has made us less safe, not more safe? I think if you want a diverse and big party, you need to allow those voices. There's not a distinction at all in the polling between Bush, Kasich, Ford, all those in third, fourth, and fifth place currently in the polls. There's not one bit of mathematical distinction. So if you tell me, oh, you're scoring 5.8 and someone scored 6.2, therefore we're going to tell the American people you're in a second class or an underclass, that's completely and utterly artificial and unfair.
So you're sure that the outcome, the effect of you not showing up won't seem that you have a bad attitude or being petulant, that you're sure that this is a winning strategy somehow?
Nobody knows what the future holds, but we do know that it's a mistake, and our campaign realized that it's a mistake to let the media or let the party pre-decide who has a chance and who doesn't have a chance. We're going to take our message directly to the people. I'll be in Iowa and New Hampshire this weekend, and tonight at 9 o'clock during the debate, we're going to have a national town hall, and all of America can turn their TV off if they want and listen to an alternative voice.
Okay, so let's talk about the eligibility of one of your rivals, and that's Ted Cruz. Do you think that he is eligible to be president of the United States?
I think the real question is, do Democrats and will Democrats challenge his eligibility? And I think they will. It would be extraordinary to have a nominee or a president who's not born in the United States. He would be the first, if he were the nominee of the president, to be not born in the United States. Democrats will bring this up, and it has never been decided by the court, so we don't know yet. But it's not something I'm challenging, but I think it's something that certainly Democrats will challenge.
So you agree with Donald Trump on this one?
I agree with a lot of people that say it's been undecided, that the courts have not. The courts have decided that if you were born in Canada and your mom was a citizen, you're a citizen. But the Constitution has these unusual words that say natural born citizen.
I mean, of course, John McCain was born in Panama on a military base, so you think that that's a caveat.
The courts decided with Barry Goldwater that if you're born in a U.S. territory, that you are a citizen. The court has decided that. The courts have not decided if you were born in a foreign country whether or not you're a natural-born citizen. Just hasn't been decided.
Let's talk about the breaking news that we had yesterday, and that is these 10 U.S. sailors who were in Iranian custody very briefly, and then this video came out of them on their knees, hands behind their heads, and one of them even apologized. Let me play for you a moment of that apology.
It was a mistake. That was our fault, and we apologize for our mistake. It was a misunderstanding. We did not mean to go into Iranian territorial water.
The Iranian behavior was fantastic while we were here. We thank you very much for your hospitality and your assistance.
What do you think? What do you think went on there?
Well, you know, it goes against the Geneva Convention to put soldiers on TV, to put prisoners of war on TV and use them as publicity pawns.
Do you think that was under duress?
What's always under duress when you've been captured, you're being, you know, whether you're being explicitly threatened with your life, you are under duress if you were captured. That's why the Geneva Convention says you're not supposed to do this ever. You're not supposed to put captured soldiers forth as publicity pawns. And so this is an indication that Iran still feels that they can play games with the United States. Now, the good news is the situation did diffuse. And so I think it's one reason why we do want somebody who's a commander-in-chief who isn't a hothead who says immediately, oh, I'm going to go blow up Tehran because of this insult. And I think that's really the message that I've had on the stage that no other Republican candidate has had, is that we need to be wary of intervention in the Middle East, but we also want a leader, not someone like Donald Trump who says, oh, I think our problem is we have not been willing enough to use our nuclear weapons. I think we need some sort of a temperament from a leader that's someone who's not eager to get involved in war.
Okay, Senator Rand Paul, we appreciate you being with us.